Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. My name is Tim. I'd like to bring in this College of Complexes to order. Andy Anderson tonight will be our moderator. The College of Complexes consists of the following. We start off with a brief announcements period. Then we move into our main presentation. Then we have a question and answer period where we ask that you have questions for our speaker. And then we have our infamous rebuttal period. We have to wrap up at 8:45 so that we can be out of here by 9 o'clock.
Welcome up to our podium, our speaker tonight, Marc Loveless. Let's give him a rousing round of applause.
I'm always very pleased and honored to be asked to participate here at the College of Complexes.
I forgot the banner, don't worry. Just give me a second.
Please, Charlie.
It's not official without the banner, I'm sorry. By the way, his credentials are, you're an officer of the Independent Voters of Illinois now, committee chair.
Yeah. All that.
Now, please proceed.
So, as I said, I'm always honored to come here because I tell everyone, if you have an idea that you think you know something about, come to the College of Complexes and they'll really give you a test. So I come prepared for the test that you guys might provide for what I'm going to say today. Let me give you a little bit of a background of the commission, how it got here, and also some of the steps that have already been taken and what we're sort of looking to see down the road at. The commission was was proposed by Commissioner Chuy Garcia in April of this year. And it was established as a place where around the Chicago port. You may be familiar with the Chicago port, where it's like it's abandoned right now, but there's lots of talk of development that's going to go on there. And so the objective is that we know that this development is going to happen one way or the other. The issue is that it happens in a conscious, purposeful manner. That it just doesn't develop in a traditional business model vacuum, but that we use this opportunity of the development of not only the port, but other locations got added on at the hearing. We had people come and say, well, you know, it's not just in the southeast side of Chicago. What about areas on the west side and on the south side and west and northwest that need economic development and those sorts of things, the type of development that we're talking about. And it was literally changed during the council meeting on the floor to include the entire county of Cook and other areas, so well within the county commission's jurisdiction. It was voted on, it was approved. I believe it was unanimous. I don't think there was a nay vote there. And then the Cook County Commission established a commission, which is the Commission on Social Innovation. And they appointed 20 members. It's an official commission of the county government. And I'm one of the 20 commissioners that they appointed. I didn't even know I was being considered as a commissioner. I just knew I was have been pushing this idea of the ideals of expanding the U.S. economy through social innovation. It's my theory that I say not just mine alone, but my theory is that the way that we have got to look at saving or retaining or improving the economic structure of society that we have right now is to expand it. And expanding it not in a traditional, not through traditional business models, but through support of social innovation, social enterprise, scaling social enterprise to expand the economy so that more people can get a chance to win. The current two things we have to acknowledge. One, the traditional business models and economies that we have known for the past 50 years have collapsed. The international markets, you know, the economists will tell you that these are not just trends of decline of trade and those sorts of things, but they're not coming back. These things, the decisions that are being made, the circumstances we find ourselves in, the reasons they're not coming back is because in other parts of the world they are using social innovation and looking at community sustainability more than just for-profit entities and for-profit traditional business motives. That can't survive because that does not take into consideration the impact of the community. You can't talk about what is known as community social responsibility. That's sort of, you know, there's a kind way to say it, but since I'm here, I don't have to say it. I'll be very direct. It's hypocritical to think that you are a corporation, that your whole objective as a corporation is to capture your market, to have less expenses and to have maximum profits, and then to turn around and say, well, we want to be a good corporate citizen, is outrageous, it's insulting, it's not true. You can't do it, and to propose it is just simply silly to waste people's time. The other thing that we can't rely on going forward, which sort of undermines real community stability, is philanthropy. Thinking that, oh, you know, once, you know, when, you know, your philanthropic adventures and those things are that they're just that that's just isn't that nice to do? Well, how about remove the circumstances that require the needs of the philanthropy? How about look at if you pay people well, if your product does not pollute, disrupt the community and the environment, then we talk about how you can proceed. Why don't we look at things from the and that's what our commission does. We're looking at and how do we look at things that will maximize the stability of a community and not just simply as it has been just disruptive for profit. Let me get to the top of the hill. Let me push everyone else down, and I'm gonna capture this space and whatever this product is. Those types of ideas are not working. They're not working, and they're resulting in economic decline. And so, I'm an all-in type of person on the whole effort of scaling social entrepreneurship, and that's where the commission is. And what it is, and let me tell you what it's not. I had someone approach me online. Facebook saying, well, that's just like the selling of the parking meters or the skyways, isn't it, or the garages. And I said, no, that's not social entrepreneurship. That's bad ideas of selling off public assets. That's just dumb. That's not what social entrepreneurship is, because those corporations, whether it was the library of the lottery or the bridges or the skyway or the garages, selling those off, that is a poor decision, because who sells off their assets? Now, what they could have done is to take that same investment and look at how you can talk about stabilizing the community with employing people who are hard to employ, with providing new opportunities and supporting local economies. And that's what we've got to do. that's one of the things that you're going to see our commission looking at, is how do we expand the support of local economies and smaller, smaller, more responsible businesses, rather than trying to feed in to major corporations or major business endeavors that have the only one purpose, and that one purpose only is for profit and for profit only. You know, for-profit corporations, that's what they are there for. We've got to come out of it's not their fault. They're for-profit. This restaurant, this is a for-profit industry, business. They want to be the best restaurant so that they can distract and push away any other competitors. They want to stand above. Well, see, that's fine, because that's a traditional business model. That is not going to survive. That is not a model that is going to sustain our economy and expand opportunities for people. The current structure as it is sets certain people up to win and certain people up to never win. And so we've got to start looking at what are the systems, what are the programs, how can we have not only our collective investment, but also what public resources can be used to support, to diversify the economy. We have some social enterprises that are very successful right here and right now here in Illinois. I would be remiss to say if I didn't say Illinois is. Our objective is that Illinois become, when I say our, I mean those of us who believe in social entrepreneurship at this level. Our objective is to see that Illinois become the Delaware of social entrepreneurship. And what I mean by that is you see in Delaware, they have their whole industry, it may be their number one industry, is corporations. If you wanted to incorporate a for-profit business today, right now, let's just say we want to do it right now, we could hook up a phone and right today in Delaware, somebody is there to set up that corporation from and have it incorporated in Delaware. That's their industry. That's their industry. It's for-profit industries. And with those industries, there come some compelling requirements. One is that you have to be dedicated to your shareholders. You have to make sure that everything you do is for the profit of your shareholders and those interested who have interest in your business. If it is not, you will set yourself up for penalties. You will be considered committing malfeasance, and they will come after you. A perfect example of that is Craigslist. You familiar with Craigslist?
Yes.
Yeah. Familiar with I gotta check my reference. Craigslist started off with four guys that started Craigslist. It's become a very successful thing. One guy decided, one of the original, main shareholders said, we want to charge, he wanted to charge people to go on Craigslist so that you don't, go on it, you're supposed to pay a fee. And the other said, no, we want to keep it as a open community, a bulletin board, for community service. That guy who wanted to put a gate on it sold his interest to eBay. eBay then comes in as a minority shareholder and puts the force the idea that they want to put a gate on it. The rest of Craigslist major shareholders said no, we want this still as a community service. They went to court. The court has ruled so far that Craigslist is wrong. That it is for a corporation to talk about, we want, instead of maximizing our profits, we want to do community good, that because they were incorporated in Delaware as a traditional for-profit corporation, they are acting irresponsibly and not in the best interest of their shareholders. This has had a chilling effect, as you can imagine, on what is, you know, what is good business and all that type of stuff. So the objective is now looking at what's more known as mission-driven ventures. And I just haven't, this book is written by a, it's called Mission-Driven Ventures, and it's written by the foremost expert on social entrepreneurship here in the country, actually. And he happens to be based here in Illinois. We've done some things in Illinois to make this a welcoming place for businesses that who are looking at alternative missions of why they're a business other than for profit. And we have some great examples that here that have been thriving for a while. I don't know if any of you have ever been to, have you ever heard of a cafe called the Overflow Cafe?
No.
It's downtown, it's on State Street and 16th. That is a mission-driven venture. Have you heard of a Safe Haven, which primarily is a shelter? They provide for focusing on services to veterans. Then there's the CARA program, or you may see people in your neighborhood that they clean up, they do landscaping and streetscaping, and you will see them, they'll say safe neighborhoods or something like that. Those are all social entrepreneurships. Those are all mission-driven ventures whose objectives are not to make as much money as fast as they can, but to, one, help people who are working for them, who are hard to employ, or they're providing a specific service of landscaping or something like that for the community, to beautify the community. And because of that, they're organized here in Illinois as what's known as L3Cs. L3Cs are limited. It takes the components of an LLC and a 501c3, and it combines them. And what we've gotten so far is the IRS has agreed that if you start a business that is mission-driven and you are a 501c3, that would still qualify. It could be a for-profit, a shoe-shining business, but you're hiring young people and providing young people with experience of work. That could be an L3C. That could be a mission-driven venture. If you are a for-profit business and you have services that you want to provide that would be more community-based, those would fall into a category of where you could establish an L3C. And Illinois, at this point, does have the most progressive L3C corporation guidelines than any other state in the union. And we've also initiated, we have a whole toolbox of things that fall in under this category of L3Cs and social entrepreneurship. Some of it may be familiar. You may have heard of co-ops, social impact bonds. These sorts of things are things that how we can diversify and strengthen the economy while also attacking and addressing other issues, such whether it's homelessness, whether it's unemployment, whether it's needed services in a community. So what the commission is out to do is to fortify this whole thing in Cook County, to begin to look at whether it's the port, or is the Chicago port, or whether it's development on transportation. We've got some proposals now on how we're going to leverage transportation opportunities to expand so that we can have, so that there can be more interstate trade by rail rather than just burning fossil fuels. And that will, in fact, improve our environment as a whole. So that's pretty much the start of it. I know I probably said a lot, and there's a lot more to be said. But I know how you guys go, so I'm going to pause for a moment. I guess the rebuttal will come up, and then
You still got some time if you want to explain some more. You got plenty of time.
Oh, I thought I had only 5 minutes.
No, you got plenty of time. You got another half an hour if you want to. You got food deserts to cover. You got. Tell us more about the commission and what it's doing.
Well, the commission it is a new commission. The commission has started. We've had three or four major commission meetings now. Whole commission meetings of the whole, and we've had over 1,000 people that have viewed, tuned into, and watched and seen the commission meetings. We're not meeting in November because we're actually sort of putting together our game plan, so to speak. But we did meet in October, and there was a presentation made regarding transportation, regarding how do we improve the rail transportation that we have, move towards high-speed rail, and also that having an impact on decreasing the impact of using fossil fuels and other types of pollution that will erode the environment. I'm also on the human capital subcommittee. There are like five subcommittees that have been established, and I'm as a member. I'm on the human capital subcommittee, and also human capital committee of the commission. So the commission has five committees. One of them is human capital. I'm on that committee. That committee has established a subcommittee, which is a subcommittee on civic engagement, young adult civic engagement, and I'm the chair of that subcommittee. And basically what we're looking at from our subcommittee standpoint is opportunities to engage young adults in becoming civically involved. We're prioritizing that civic engagement, which is something that's not really done or being done in any other arena. So it is a concentrated effort by this governmental entity to encourage young adults to get involved with shaping policy, with developing best practices in regards to civic engagement. And so we've had a couple of meetings, and we're moving towards having a major gathering, face-to-face meeting with young adults and young emerging civic engagement practitioners. I am also another part that I'm working on. Well, it feeds into this. I'm also a student at Roosevelt University. Roosevelt is the only university in the country that has in the U.S. that has a social entrepreneurship degree program, master's degree program. And I was very purposeful. I'm not, Roosevelt is a social justice university. And that's a good place to start. But I'm not going to Roosevelt because I intend to become, some great muckety muck, but more or less to go through the system, to go through the process, and to see how we can really expand even this whole process that we look at of social entrepreneurship and getting other people to get into the program, not just this program, not to just get into it for the purpose of getting into it or for bragging rights, but to get into it so that we can expand and scale this industry. And that's the whole objective, is expanding and scaling the industry of civic, of social entrepreneurship. One of the things, like I heard Charlie talk about food deserts, that's actually one of the things that the commission will be looking at, as to what are some strategies around that are more than just throwing up a major chain in an area and say, there you go, there you've got it. That's, if it's a for-profit business, whatever the business is named, you know, it could be Walmart, it could be, we have a great new Mariano's in my neighborhood. I love it. but Mariano's or Walmart or Target or whatever, these are, you cannot expect those to be the engines that support small business, that support economic diversity. They're just not there to do that. They're not, the only reason they're there is because their studies have shown that they can make a huge profit by being where they are. Not just a profit, but a huge profit. And when we start looking at how we engage, and I'll tell you, it's a little, you know, people are talking about, you know, what this, you know, having a lot of angst around this election. I'm just as disappointed and disheartened as anyone as far as the election results. But the reality is that there is an opportunity to expand our economy in a way that supports smaller businesses, mission-driven efforts that will lead to community stability. And this, I mean, this, what you would call precarious situation that our economy is in, can at some point begin, maybe under these circumstances, to be worked out, which is going to go beyond any candidacy or any administration, whether Democrat or Republican. This is or anything in between. This is not one of those issues where you can raise a flag and say I'm good for this and I'm good for that, because you can't be good, because if you be good for it means that you're willing to look at and expand your thought and look at what governmental. They talked about governmental restrictions. Let me tell you something. The government promotes, and governmental rules around business promote certain businesses to succeed. And because of those protections, we really don't have a free market economy. We have an economy that we have a controlled economy. And the control comes in, you know, when they allow certain chosen industries to have monopolies, like the energy industry. The way they're operating now and the way they have operated in the past 50 years are sustained through the protections and guidelines of governmental regulations. So what we have an opportunity to do through social entrepreneurship is to take that circumstance and to say, what is the better good for the community? Not just what is the better good for corporate, for ComEd, or for NICOR, or for whatever smaller subsidiary that they would put out there, but in the context of community stability, what is it, or how can we provide those services in a better way, and even in a more competitive way? When you look at the issue of housing, one of the groups that I mentioned is a safe haven, which is located on Roosevelt. They're, again, they began primarily servicing veterans and homeless veterans. They've now expanded into servicing homeless people and homeless families. And they've also expanded into housing. Redeveloping. So they have a multi-million-dollar housing initiative that is goes from here to Wisconsin and Indiana that will that provides housing development, that provides housing for people who are hard who have had a hard time at securing and maintaining housing. That has a significant impact on stabilizing a community because they provide the wraparound services that are needed for people who have been chronically homeless or have, you know, and then it provides a community that is diverse. You look at, like, I'm trying to remember, there is the landscaping company that I was talking to you about. You've seen them, they have like lime colored vests on when they're out there cleaning up. Most of the people there are formerly incarcerated. They are living out here on the street, you know, in the community, and we're looking to, and they need work. They need work. So what Carl, which is the group, which is a non-for-profit that does workforce development, which is actually started from Old St. Pat's Church. They have a major job development piece that they do anyway for all other jobs, but with this neighborhood landscaping or streetscaping thing that they do, they employ people for under a time period, give them skills. Some of them haven't maintained a job in a while. This gets them a firm footing on getting back into the job market, and that's a social enterprise. On the west side, there's a company that really started out of a necessity of trying to find people a profession that they can take that's portable and they could set up any place. So they decided they were harvesting bees. So now they've created a line of cosmetics and skincare that's infused with bee honey. And Sweet Beginnings is the name of it. So you can look it up. And there are other projects, smaller projects that are currently working as social enterprises that are employing people, providing healthy options for people, nutritional options as well. So what this commission will do with those people, and I have to say, elements of all those industries are members of this commission as well. Like we have 16 Blue 1647, the founder of that, which is a incubator of small businesses on the west side, sits on the commission. The alderman from the 10th Ward, which is that ward where the Chicago Port actually is, sits on the, is also a member of the commission. Another thing, director of what used to be Chicago Donors Forum, which is now Forefront, also, it's called Forefront, it used to be called Chicago Donors Forum, it's called My Forefront, which is where all corporations, all foundations or whatever, meet, learn, and collaborate, sits on the commission. They're using their investment dollars, and that's another thing I don't know if a lot of folks know, but there's a thought within the communities of philanthropy, and people think that if you talk to folks who are reliant on it, they will say, wow, it seems like that grant dollars are drying up, or they're, you know, this corporation, whether Chicago Community Trust or whoever else, it seems as if that they're shifting their priorities. Well, they are. They are shifting their priorities. It's not that the money's drying up. It's that there's a school of thought that when you give a grant, that's considered dead money. Because you give someone a grant and it's to help that one, that you don't know how it's going to turn out or anything. You hope it turns out well. You know that the mission is good and you want to see it turn out well. But that's considered a dead donation. There's another realm of giving, again, like I told you, thanks to the IRS's interpretation. You never hear anyone say thanks to the IRS, but this time we'll. Because of their interpretation, under PRI, which is purpose-related investments. And what has happened is with philanthropic giving groups, such as Community Trust, Joyce Foundation, and others, they've expanded their PRI portion of the monies that they are going to grant out. PRIs are investments in mission-driven businesses, mission-driven ventures. So they are looking to find more opportunities to invest in for-profit businesses whose mission is not just for profit, but who have a stronger community, a broader base of providing whatever service or whatever product that they want to bring forward. It's got to be other than just, you can't just say, oh, I just want to open up a fee-infused product business. That wouldn't get it. But if you were to say, we're hiring people who are formerly incarcerated, who have records, who we're giving them a skill, these sorts of things, these are the things that you're getting the major giving agencies looking at. And they get a return on that. Sometimes the investment, like I heard one of the grant officers says, now, we expect this is an investment, and we're expecting to get our money back if we can. Because usually the return on their investment is between 0% and 3%. And they're okay with that. Because they understand that they're solving a bigger issue and getting the return is not the priority. What the priority is changing people's lives. So I think I'll stop.
All right, very good.
You'll be answering questions.
Oh, you're not going.
Oh, I thought the yes.
Yeah.
But I thought it was the rebuttal first.
No, it's the questions first.
Okay.
Go ahead, Gene.
Okay, I guess we're going to handle rebuttals differently. You talked a little bit about the finances, but obviously, since almost all the commissioners voted for this, there's very little county money. How much county money, and where are you going to get the rest of the money? Is it from PRIs, or is it from some other source? Where is the money coming from? What is the county putting in, and what other monies are coming out other than PRIs?
That's the only way. They're not giving us no budget.
So you have no budget.
We have, because Commissioner Garcia is the chair, his office is sharing as far as the staffing and that sort of thing. As far as any other things, we're trying to solicit PRI investments in our commission, and then that's because we had to pass the commission revenue neutral, so that it didn't cost the county anything.
So, thank you.
What's PRI?
Purposeful related investment.
That's what you just said.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Andy, are you ready to moderate questions?
I'm sorry, program-related investment.
Program-related investment.
All right.
Okay, next question.
Just on the point.
Go ahead.
I wanted to get your take on they built the Whole Foods down there in Inglewood. Is that a good fit for that neighborhood? And is there any, like, hiring requirements that...
They have all that. But, I mean, you got to keep this in mind, though. It is still Whole Foods. I haven't been down there, but I'm told the prices are not as steep. There's a couple of ways that a grocer can do that. And I don't know what in fact there, I haven't been there. But what I can tell you is that I know that there was a group of real estate students or real estate majors that looked at that area, including the Whole Food, and also how it's the need for supporting smaller businesses to make that area more thriving. And the developer of that Whole Foods, of that spot there, had taken on those Roosevelt students and was implementing their plan. And their purpose is real estate from a social justice standpoint. So there's some attempt at continuity at community stabilization with that project. So it's not just typical developers development stuff.
Okay.
Yes.
Are there other projects that the county is working towards now with similar goals and considerations?
This commission is initiating those things. I can also tell you that there are some, I know of what's known as social SBI, social impact bonds that are going on that focus on specific areas. And one I know works with is focused on juveniles. It's a project that I think it's like 400 juveniles who are dually positioned, and the juvenile system, they are they may be, you know, child protective services as well as juvenile. Their child protective service as well as juvenile detainees. So they're dually positioned, and they've got like 400 that they're putting wraparound services around. It's an investment, you know, and the objective is to see if we provide all these services. It's a coordination of like 5 or 6 different agencies, and hopefully the outcome will be that the kids will be have more stable and successful lives. But we're the ones that are issuing these types of things. We're pushing them out there. Charlotte?
Go ahead. There was another person before me.
Marc. Now, if I wanted to build a factory, big factory, are you and your pals going to show up telling me who I can hire and then what I can make? Let's say I want to make AK-47 rifles, assault rifles. Are you going to say that's not socially acceptable product or something? Is this probably a new form of regulation?
Probably so. Well, let me say this.
How do you guys make regulations when you're out of the
Here's the deal. If you want to make, if you want to create AK-47s, we're going to ask the questions, how does it contribute towards community stability? We're going to pursue you at that level. And we're going to say, okay, you know, I mean, there's going to be lots of questions, a lot of hard questions that we're going to ask, and we're going to keep asking them until we get an understanding as to how it, because see, we've got, we can't just because you come in and say, I'm a business and I'm going to hire, you know, 2,000 people and this is wonderful and we're going to make this wonderful thing that blows up the earth. No, we're not doing it. It's not worthwhile. It's not beneficial, it doesn't add to the stability of the community, it's disruptive.
And so, if I show up and I'm going to say I'm going to offer every 2,000 high-paying jobs, what's the community going to say to you?
We're going to have
buy one of my rifles.
We're going to have conversation with the community to real. We've got to have these conversations to have a realization that if we don't have vision when we're talking about what we're doing, and opportunities for accountability, the short term is not good enough. We've been operating like that for 50 years. You lost. You know, we're trying to do something so that we can all win.
What about, say I want to make marijuana plant or grow it in Cook County at the same thing? What would the commission do for me?
Actually, that is a emerging conversation. because you know, it's like, what would be your purpose? If your purpose is to just be the best marijuana grower or distributor in a for-profit traditional business model, I think we want to talk to you about how can you diversify your thinking about this thing. If you're providing a medical public health advantage, then let's talk about and prioritize that. But if it's just for the profit margin, just because you see this as a profitable business and you can make or the people who are associated with you can make a lot of money, that's just not enough. We gotta look at how that is going to impact, where are you gonna put it, who's gonna be impacted by it, how is having a place that where you're talking about requiring lots of water, how's that gonna impact on the surrounding water supplies? I mean, we're gonna ask a lot of these types of questions.
You know, the thing that scares me off about this whole commission thing is there's other counties out here, preferably like down in DeKalb, McHenry County, Cook. They'll just go somewhere else where there's a more favorable regulatory environment.
Well, then maybe they should go there. Because what we're gonna do here is look at stabilizing our economy and expanding our economy and stabilizing our communities. Now, if the others don't want to do it, or they can go if you want to exploit your exploitation of resources, please don't do it here then.
Get out of town.
Well, I would
more
say
questions.
Get out.
Here. Okay.
Hopefully, we can reason together.
All right. Gene.
This is my second question.
Yeah, no problem. Go ahead.
Mark, you said that you're going to Roosevelt. You said you're on this commission. Charlie said you're on the IVI. But looking at you, my eyes are bad, but you look more than 22 years of age. So what else have you done? I think I've heard your name. So what else have you done? Tell us about yourself.
Oh God. Well, I just... this is my third event today. The other event I was at was, I'm also the coordinator of the Southside Democracy for America. And I been involved with, I could, you know, when I like to freak out the IRS, so when they ask me what my work is, I always put civil rights advocate. That just throws, they don't know what to do with that. So, and that's why I see myself. And I worked as, I worked for Reverend Jackson for Rainbow Push for the past, as a volunteer staff person, volunteer, coordinator, contract worker for over 25 years. And I was the first LGBT elected official in the state in 1993. So that's...
I just...
Thank you.
I just Googled your name, and tell us about the CJR, the...
Coalition for Justice and Respect. I'm the founding executive director of CJR. We were an organization that, in 2006, December the 30th, there was an incident that took place in Woodlawn, where there was a party of LGBT people, and they were at a private home. Then during their party, some other guys came in and started shooting into the house using anti-gay epithets. When the community came together to figure out what was going on, the city of Chicago said, well, we wouldn't consider that a hate crime. We just think that's they don't have hate crimes in that area. They just have crime. So that's just part of crime. That sort of outraged people, because clearly when they're using these epithets, it really is something else. So we ended up getting this, so we organized, we staged the first march on 2007 on MLK Day, down 79th Street, calling for justice and respect of LGBT people. And we held a community meeting, and we got a couple hundred people. We thought it was a room like this. We thought it was going to be big enough. We're going to say, well, we'll have to go to a little table to set up, we thought. But as the people came, you know, a couple hundred folks came, and then we did our march, and there was another couple hundred folks up down 79th Street. First time anything like that had happened in an African-American community. And so we commemorate that every once in a while. So we've done things like, we had the first summer jobs program in 2008 that focused primarily on LGBT, African-American LGBTQ young adults and their allies, which we employ over 90 people from all over the city, but was based, thankfully, in Congressman Danny Davis' office. So.
Hey, Dave.
Okay. Well,
go ahead.
Okay.
David.
If your suggested committee is going to decide what is good for the community and what isn't good for the community, and is going to let a businessman operate or not operate on that basis, then that sets up the stage for a lot of corruption, a lot of bribes, and also for a dictatorial posture of deciding that, well, we don't want this guy because he's too capitalistic and so forth. And that sounds, the whole thing sounds very, very socialistic to me. And it also sounds very Barack Obama-ish.
Barack Obama.
Well, I don't know That was meant as a compliment or...
Let me clarify that. Mr. Obama accomplished nothing during his administration.
Okay.
So therefore, that's the way I meant it.
Okay. Well, let me say this, that the current for-profit economic structure that we have, we've been operating from for earnestly for the past 50 years. And the result of that has been less people have been able to succeed and less industries have been able to, businesses have been able to compete fairly. We haven't had fair competition. Whenever you have a situation where you hear businesses are too big to fail, those are the businesses that need to close up right away. Because we don't do monopoly well unless they're supported and encouraged by the government and protected by the government. I don't think that it sets up for corruption. What we're talking about is shining a light on things so that we can avoid corruption. I don't know anything more corrupt than to say that we're going to have this financial institution survive and let this one die because why we just like them better. It doesn't, that, I mean, either we have a free, real free enterprise system that says that some of the people who are most protected by governmental regulations, and we've got to really begin to look at this face forward, that there are governmental regulations that protect for-profit businesses and corporations. It protects them. It says who can get in. You can't just start an airline. You can't decide, oh, I have a great idea for an airline, I'm going to start an airline. That's not going to work. You have got to be permitted into that industry. You can't even just say, oh, I want to start a great baseball team, better than the Cubs. That you are not allowed to buy into it if you've got $10 billion. So we have controlled economy and we have to accept it. And also we have to also understand that the reason why the international circumstances are having such an adverse effect now is because those in other parts of the world, they're looking at things from a more social impact, community sustainability, and they're saying, no, you can't, you're worried about NAFTA. They got a lot more problems than NAFTA because when they go to other countries, they're not allowing the exploitation to happen of the workers. You know, you just can't do it as well. And that's why current international trends are turning. And that's why this business economist, conservative, progressive, anybody in between are saying, this is not a trend. This is the new normal. We have got to figure out how to work within this. And so what we're trying to do at the commission is to say, we want to accelerate working within it by supporting local development in a responsible way.
It sounds like a lot like the Civilian Conservation Corps during the Roosevelt administration, where they were thinking outside the box of new ways of addressing inequality. It's as American as apple pie. So could you comment on that?
Well, it is. I mean, I just think that it very much is that we've got to look at innovative ways to reach the objectives that we need to. I mean, these things, okay, let's face it. The development of the port in and of itself, it's gonna happen. If the commission wasn't there, if we all go away for 20 years, it's gonna happen. The issue is under what context and who
gets to participate, who gets to succeed. And what our purpose is to make a hard wall that's set, develop, not that kind of wall, but to develop some morals and principles in our, and the business actions and the developments that go on.
Raj.
Last 40 years, I'm hearing same story. For one rescue or other rescue. During that 40 years, 30 million Latinos walked across the border, mm-hmm. and they got the jobs, and they're doing reasonably better. And why black community not doing better than Latinos? Because some of them cannot speak English, even, and black guys can speak English. What, where, and what went wrong?
Here's what, well, first of all, what went wrong is that you have a business structure, a business model that says that the way to succeed is to have low expenses and go for high profits. Now, that low expense means that I can pay somebody else. If it means I don't pay you an equitable wage, nowhere else in the world can you have these huge wage gaps. Do you know, in other parts of the world, you can, once you have so much money, they stop paying you interest. And then you have to pay a fee. You have to pay a fee for hoarding money, because they understand hoarding money and is something that destabilizes community. That's number one. The other thing is that if we just continue to hope against reason that the current business structure is going to somehow get us somewhere else, then that's just, I think, it's proven that's a waste of time. It doesn't happen. And you find in other countries, other economies, they are doing things like, you know, okay, they want to invest in ventures that they may not make a profit on, but that's okay, because if they don't invest it, they're going to have to pay a penalty for hoarding this money. Money hoarding, and 900% pay disparity between your frontline worker and your CEO is unacceptable around the world. They're not doing that. They're not allowing for that. And so that is having a problem for us.
Sir, you're not answering my question.
Okay.
My question is that Latinos have the same situation, same businesses, same thing, okay, as a black young man had. Mm-hmm. They both had the same situation. This one group prospering, another group are not. The one group doesn't have as many social organizers, and other group has a lot of social organizers, like Barack Obama. Barack Obama came, and he was a community organizer, and he said, One America. He went 8 years in Washington, D.C., did not do anything for black community.
Okay, I'm trying to figure
so,
out.
So what about the, why Latinos?
Every immigrant group.
Why Latinos have to do this?
Which group are you saying succeeds more, the blacks or the Latino? Okay, all right. Now, let me just say this to you. The advantage that you may see there, and oftentimes if they are not citizens, is an advantage in poverty. When you start talking about that, because they won't pay, because if you have a American-born, orientated person coming to a job, they're expecting a wage that is different than somebody who is just trying to survive. That's just the situation. I mean, because I present I present as a person who would say, you know, if I was in a negotiating position based on what I know, what my experience is, where I've, you know, been, you know, what I should be accommodated for, I know what I should be able to expect as far as performing a job. But when you get somebody else who is beside me, who may have similar experiences except in another country, and then you're going to pay them less, or even you have situations of, let's talk about skilled and unskilled labor, how we have laws that encourage U.S. corporations to bring even skilled laborers here, and then because they're bringing them here, they pay them less, where instead of hiring someone locally at an equitable pay rate, they would use immigration laws to bring in workers, to pay them less, and say, well, I'm paying you less because I'm bringing you here as a citizen. You get to live here, and so I'll pay you less. And so whatever the cost of the immigration and the salary combined doesn't equal what they should be actually paying for that same position of an American worker.
I'm sorry. If I'm starving, I'm going to take any job.
Charlie.
All right.
You got a question, Charlie?
Yeah, it sounds like you want to pass a regulation or rule that if I try to open up Chuck's hot dog stand, you say, oh, no, that's not allowed. But if I call it the People's Co-op stand, then the only thing you're going to allow are co-ops, right?
Nope. And you can't just call it the People's Hot Dog. I mean, you can do whatever you want. But what I mean, this is not the commission, but me, like in other parts of the world, if you are a mission-driven adventure or a co-op or something like that, you get advantages such as you don't have to pay any taxes, any federal taxes, period, on your income. So you can open up Peoples, and Peoples can be your for-profit traditional business hot dog stand, great. But if Chuck's opens up and their objective is to provide culinary skills to people, to provide work experience to folks who don't have it, provide utilizing a space that is in a community that is depressed or that would not have investments, guess what? We're going to do everything we can to support Chuck's. And you can have Peoples be your for-profit traditional business, and we'll see what happens at the end.
We have a quick question. Who would monitor? After, like Charlie says, a business is set up, is there any kind of monitoring system to see that it's providing help to the community?
Also,
how would that work?
Yes. Also, as members of the commission, are the actual technocrats or the bureaucrats who would make sure that if you say you're going to do this as a business under these guidelines, they make sure that they're charged with making sure
they check on you every 6 months or a year or something, see how it's going.
I don't know what their actual plan is, but I do know that they're required to monitor it. Yeah.
Pat.
Yeah. Getting back to this business of comparable worth for pay, real life situation. I am a newspaper reporter who at various times has been a managing editor of a medium-sized community newspaper. Guy comes into my office, he is a native Chicagoan, knows all of the aldermen, knows half the police commanders, his father drinks with some of them, and he wants a job as a reporter covering Northside News. Another guy comes in, he may have been a reporter, well, the guy I'm thinking of had been a reporter for a newspaper in India. Now, their system is quite different from ours. I need a guy who is ready to hit the ground running. If I hire him today, I expect that he is going to be ready to cover stories next week, and that he is going to be a very, very quick study, as we all were getting into this business. So why should I pay the guy that just got off the boat from India anywhere near the same as I'm going to pay the guy who can do twice the job?
Well, you shouldn't. I mean, what often happens is that, and I don't know about someone who's just coming over here, who's just getting off the ship, but what will often happen is that students will hire students. Okay, I don't know about someone just coming here. About they shouldn't qualify for the equitable. I mean, you would pay them equitably based on that. But I think that what sometimes happens in your industry, and I'm just saying specifically, I'm globally just thinking about it myself, is that students, because they are students, will get hired. In contrast to a seasoned reporter, because you could pay them less. I'll even give you a better example. I'll give you the industry that I come from. I'm a paralegal, was a member of the board of the Illinois Paralegal Association, been a paralegal for 25, 30 years. When the markets crashed in the 2000s and all that stuff, when things were going haywire, before then, there was plenty of work for paralegals. I mean, we even set up a paralegal certification during this time, because there were so many people saying they were paralegals, and it was like, but you don't, you're a clerk, you're a law clerk, you're not a paralegal. So we set up this criteria for qualification. And when times got hard and corporations were firing attorneys, there were attorneys that were coming in and taking paralegal positions, pushing paralegals out of work. And the law firms and places that were hiring them were fine with that, because if they got on one end a certified paralegal with 10 years experience, and then they've got on the other end a newly minted certified, board certified attorney with 2 years experience or no experience, and it's just a business decision would be go with the attorney, because you can get farther with having a credentialed attorney than a paralegal and what can be signed off on.
Even though the attorneys hire paralegals, because many attorneys are not that good at the detail work.
But this is what has been happening, is that the attorneys were saying, I will work as a paralegal because I just need to work. Well, you know that means you're not going to get paid $40 an hour. You may only get paid $20 an hour. They didn't care. They don't care. They will take the $20. And thus displace the paralegals.
Shall we go to rebuttals now?
Yes, let's go to rebuttals.
Okay, okay. Have a round for our speaker.
Okay. We got
okay,
some time.
We're entering the rebuttal period. Can we have a show of hands for who wants to give a rebuttal, and we get a total count here? 6, 7, and
you are
that
eight.
Would be 8. Okay, we'll have 8 slots. That
would
be
4 minutes each.
4 minutes each. Okay.
And if you're, we'll be flexible with it too, but.
Let's try to contain it to 4 minutes each. Okay, Jonathan's first.
Slim Brundage, founder of the college, said, I hear people say everybody should lift themselves up with their own bootstraps. Sure, but what about the millions who don't have any bootstraps? In 1937, Franklin Delano Roosevelt said something very similar. He said, these unhappy times call for the building of plans that build from the bottom up and not from the top down, that put their faith once more in the forgotten one at the bottom of the economic pyramid. In the vast majority of communities, though it may be true progressives don't hold public office, in the hearts and minds of we the people, they shine great clarity on the ideas that are victorious. The books that we give to friends and family, the neighbors and even strangers we suggest websites to, the documentaries we learn from, the struggles we work for, build, and contribute to. So at least in that way, they did win. They're the sources of genuine leadership that represent a thorough articulation of another way to live as a society, which is peaceful and democratic. This example of lost at the polls but won in our souls reminds us to continue building solidarity and keep showing up and organizing until we reach a point in time when we won't be suggesting systematic change or recommending systematic change, but peacefully and democratically taking power and enacting it ourselves. Dennis Kucinich, Cynthia McKinney, Rosa Clemente, Jill Stein, Sherry Hankala, Ajamu Baraka, Bernie Sanders. These candidates ran some of the most recent campaigns that championed a long list of the most popular ideas with the public, such as developing new economic models, yet were excluded from the most important broadcasts on U.S. mainstream media outlets. If any of these candidates ran for high-level public office in other countries, their platforms would not only be acknowledged, well-known, and highly respected, they would be the front-runners. And even if they lost to another less progressive candidate, the public would still overwhelmingly expect the policies that had been thoroughly debated and familiar as proven solutions were a lot more likely to result in success compared to the ones of the past, for the most pressing needs of the people, would be enacted. They'd be passed into federal law without delay or obstruction, which we've had for the last 8 years. So, you know, when you say someone failed, it's easy to say they failed when the whole entire plan of the opposition was to make sure that they failed. Yeah. Enact the policies that communities most cared about and serve the demands of all the people. Not just the base, not just the wealthiest members of their base, not just the members who supported their campaign from the very beginning, we the people. So when they say we're going to hit the ground running, we know what they mean. You know, when you hear Paul Ryan say that, they plan on taking government's course of policy in all the country in the radically dangerous, extremely ill-advised economic, educational, military, environmental, civic direction. The question I ask myself is, why did we not abolish the Electoral College immediately after the 2000 Florida disenfranchisement? I got 5 seconds, so I'd like to suggest 4 books. One's by Ari Berman, it's called Give Us the Ballot. One's by Jane Mayer, it's called Dark Money. One's by David Daley, it's called Rat Fudged, and that's not the actual title, but we've got families here. And Zachary Roth, The Great Suppression. You know, they did win in our souls. So I don't care what the polls say.
I think the reason Trump won is when he first made a speech, he laid out the fact that a lot of people are in jeopardy and they don't know exactly when their next meal or their next month's rent will be paid. So people were desperate. And he told one little truth in that. Other than that, it was all lies. And people were so disgusted with what's going on with the so-called Democrats. They got so frustrated with it. That's why they voted them in. they didn't care about the rest, about his rapes, about his lies, about his contradictions. There's nothing along those lines. They only cared about one thing. When will the next meal come? When will the next month rent be paid? What will happen to their kids once they grow up and they have no future? And so they were desperate and they voted for him. As far as the speaker's concerned, he's right. When you have a system based on profit and profit alone, that's what happens. You get a handful of people that control everything and the rest have to struggle and survive on the day-to-day level just to get by. And unless you have a type of society that puts need ahead of profit, and need is the basic rule in society and not profit, then you can have a better society. But the way we're going, greed and need are two contradictions that can never be resolved, except one or the other taking over. And so far we got greed that was taking over. Now that's not going to last forever, because one day the contradictions will get so bad that you'll have a depression that makes 1929 look like a tea party or a birthday party by comparison. And that's what you're going to have eventually, especially if Republicans come in and they try to take away Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, and the other needs that people have. You're going to see such an uproar. Like right now, we're having all these demonstrations throughout the country. Somebody said 100,000 people participated in New York against Trump, and this will multiply by the hundreds. And then you only have a type of system that is based on greed. As long as you have a system based on greed, you're going to have wars, you're going to have desperation, you're going to have poverty, you're going to have homelessness, and that's the type of system we have. We have to get rid of it.
My name is Raj Patel. Hillary Clinton lost. Simply, he gambled on black people, he gambled on Latinos, and they did not deliver. That's one. She did not ask white people to vote for her, and they didn't. It's as simple as that. Okay? And to say that we are moral people, that's stupidity. We are not moral people. Come on, guys. We have 50% divorce rate. You know, we have a wife will go away if some millionaire smooch her. Okay? Her husband will go away if she finds a better deal. This happens. Come on. In New York City, it happens more than that, and Hillary should have known it. Anyway, coming to current speaker, I have lots of problem with what is happening in the black community for the last 40 years. Do you know what he said about the whole speech was about? It's not empowerment, not working hard, not going out and, you know, and competing with everybody. It was kind of, hey, you baby cannot do it, and I got to feed you. It didn't work in America. That is not America. You got to realize in America, from the very beginning, people who went on a trail, they suffered a lot. Tell me, you should go on a waste and see it. Those people who did go silver mining, gold mining, lots of people lost their salt and their lives. Okay? America is always what difficult. America is a great cost in a human life and human misery to succeed in America. That is true. And if black leaders have going to say to black community that, hey, you are exceptional, you do not have to do that. We are going to feed you. You know, you can dream about and you can talk about. I've been talking like 40 years. It's not going to work. There are black guys out there who work hard, who get educated, who go to white community and learn from white guys and other guys, and they are succeeding. It's not that all black are destitute. They are succeeding. lots of people coming out. I, in my building, lots of black guys live in. You know, do you know something? They work hard. I talk to them. They think very upbeat. They talking about their future. And I tell you some other thing. On a lakefront, I must have interviewed 50 young people during last summer. I asked them about their family, their religion, their dreams. Do you know something I found it? The parents, these are all white people, parents who train their kids and work with them and understood them, they did better than those people who say who are in a church, who are more into church and more into that we are, this is our rules and regulations, they did not do so well. They were unhappy. Example is there. America is not going to be easy. You teach black people, work hard, educate hard, go out in a white community and do your thing.
Okay. 4 minutes.
Study and work hard.
Good evening. Well, our election is over with, and Donald Trump has won. Fortunately for the people, Donald Trump has won. Hillary Clinton told the people she was going to continue the policies of Obama, which after 8 years have not worked. And she said she was going to raise taxes. Generally speaking, nobody wants to vote for someone who is going to raise taxes. We now have a president who is a businessman in office who understands business, or he wouldn't be worth about $6 billion. And I believe Mr. Trump is going to bring about prosperity. And my prediction would be within 24 months, we'll all be doing a whole lot better. And joblessness will not be a problem. I think that we will be in very, very good shape in that way. Only we're going to have to be patient to give them a chance to get it together. More to the subject, though, our speaker tonight gave us democracy, 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 but this isn't a democracy. This is a republic. And when I said my Pledge of Allegiance in school, I said I pledge allegiance to the flag and to the republic for which it stands. I never said to the democracy for which it stands. And so as a republic, as long as you don't break the laws, you have a right to go into business. You don't have to go to some community organization in the name of democracy and say, can I open up a print shop on 63rd Street? Or can I open up a tattoo parlor? Or can I do this or can I do that? If it wasn't against the law, you could do it. And it worked out very good. The more that government has interfered with what businesses can and can't do, especially smaller businesses, our economy has faltered. So we need less government involvement so that people can go ahead and take the initiative, go into business, and be successful. Thank you very much.
You know, you might wonder why we Republicans are so adamant about government control, about regulation, about trouble that comes when you have a little bit of excessive over-regulation. The truth is, some of it is good, like, for example, the Clean Air and Clean Water Act, and it has done a lot of good to clean up the environment. But did you also realize that consumers do want to also clean up the environment? And they will patronize businesses that make products that are eco-friendly and do have good practices in management. One of the reasons why people shop Whole Foods is because of their call to quality, even though their prices may be a little bit higher. The other thing you gotta realize that too is that a lot of businesses want good workers to come in, but a good living wage at a job sometimes is not a right, but it's something that needs to be earned. Thomas Friedman and Michael Mandelbaum in a book called Why America Has Been Left Behind and What We Need to Do to Succeed talk about four basic principles that need to be happening to make our country great again. The first one is our infrastructure. We're going to need to do some serious upgrading to it. India's doing it, China's doing it, and probably at a much faster rate than we are, especially with their One Belt, One Road policy. Two, we're going to have to deal with a looming budget deficit and what happens when we get the call to reckoning. We're going to have to do some auditing of our agencies. For example, the Defense Department's never undergone a complete audit. Three, we're going to have to take a look at our energy solutions. And sorry folks, wind and solar ain't going to do it. It's going to have to be part nuclear. And as upon looking through the Republican platform this week alone, I noticed a little word in there called they're supporting the development of thorium-based molten salt reactors, like what China's doing, which I believe could really contribute to getting off our fossil fuel addiction, as so many people see it. But you also have to realize, too, we've done a lot of cleaning up in the last 100 years, particularly in the city of Chicago. When you had, you know, before the development of things like public sewers and public water, the paving of roads, and of course the development of a lot of good governance with the health departments and things, the environment was much, much more dirtier. And we also have something to do with the so-called too big to fail. And it's the remedy has been around for well over 100 years. It's called the Sherman Antitrust Act. It was first done by the first Roosevelt administration. We need to get back to some of these basic principles. And yes, unions have done a good job of keeping workers well and regulated and good. Because it does, you will have a few employers out there who are tempted to get the most labor at the cheapest price. It's part of the marketplace. But when there's a shortage of labor, either mechanization takes place or the wages do go up for unskilled workers. What can you do, though, to get out of your own simple fiscal debacle or your own problems with your own lack of economy or your own unskilled jobs? There are community colleges. There are places for you to go and get higher skills for better work. And as I need to be wrapping up, I've been re-looking at Trump, what he can do to be a president, and I find a lot of parallels in the building of the Cubs franchise and how they won the World Series and how he can learn quite a few things from him. I'll be speaking on that on May 14th.
Okay, we had a presidential election, and the president has been elected. But America remains divided and suffering. It doesn't make any difference who was elected. It's still there. Hillary was voted in by more than 16,800,000. Trump was somewhat less. But Hillary was voted in by over half a million more than Trump. But nevertheless, Trump gets in. So right on the edge. We're still a divided country. So if you think, oh, he got the vote, okay, he's in now. I don't think it's that simple.
Yes.
My recommendation? Let's not pay attention to Blaine. Forget the damn Blaine. Pay attention to the pain and the suffering. What government that people may do. This is not something that can be done from a place of power, only from a place of listening to each other.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, Pat.
Yes, we have a new president-elect. A president-elect who ran largely on the fact that he was not a politician and he was a businessman. Now, that would be reassuring if our problems were only economic and the man were indeed a skilled businessman. However, the man has at least four bankruptcies under his belt. He has a reputation for operating in a fairly untrustworthy manner, even amongst his own colleagues. He has a problem paying people that he is under contract to pay, including some of his lawyers. And yet, he says, don't worry, I'm not a politician. I'm not one of those guys in Washington. Now, Washington is a city where a lot of things are done by horse trading. You work, you represent a farming district. I represent an urban district. So we'll sit down. I want money for improving our infrastructures in our major cities. You want money for the agricultural interests. We can sit down. We can do a deal. This is how things are done in Washington, and they're generally done very effectively. But he likes to say, don't worry, I'm not a politician. Well, now, that's a little bit like going into surgery, and the doctor who is going to do brain surgery on you says, don't worry, I'm not one of those doctors. I'm a paralegal, and I'm just learning this. You would be a little bit uncomfortable going under the knife to a guy like this. Likewise, if you were charged with a capital crime, and your lawyer that's been appointed to you by the court because you cannot afford the kind of lawyer it would take to spare you from the hangman, and he says, don't worry, I'm a paralegal. This is my first case as a lawyer, and I'll take the bar exam sometime next year. I guarantee you, the next thing you're probably going to ask for is a priest. Because the chances are you're going to make the acquaintance of the hangman at the end of this little drama. No, you want a guy who is experienced. You want a guy who is honest. You want a guy who is not totally greedy. As a matter of fact, I kind of admire the statement made by one Southern governor who, when he ran, said, I'm not going to promise that I will not steal anything. I'm just not going to steal with both hands like those varmints over there. You know, I mean, the fact is that everything is relative. So now we have Donald Trump, who probably would have been very successful selling snake oil. Certainly he would have made a good TV evangelist. But would he make a good president? I have serious question when the guy doesn't have the faintest idea what the job involves. He promises to do things which are patently unconstitutional, and if he kept his campaign promises, he'd be impeached. He says totally crazy things that could probably get him removed from office by that amendment most people don't think about, but it's in the Constitution, allowing the president to be removed if he is incapable of performing the job. He has shown great evidence before he has even come to Washington of being incapable to do the job. Now, I am in favor of giving him the very best mental health care possible after he has his nervous breakdown and after we're at war with half the world and after we have a major depression. Not that he is any greedier than the rest, simply because it would be about the same as my having my five-year-old grandson climb into a high-performance jet fighter and let him play airplane. We know what's going to happen there. The plane will land in Canada. There'll be a big explosion in Ottawa. And the Canadian Army, all 27,000 of them, will be marching on Washington. I'm not so much worried about Donald Trump himself as I am about the people who place such great faith in this man. Like the woman who said a week before he was elected, and she said, "What's your opinion of Mr. Trump?" And she said, "He's my savior." "He's your savior?" This was her response. "He's my savior." This tells you a little bit about some of the people that signed on to Trump's wagon. But there are others. Trump was capable of appealing to some deep-seated fears among people who weren't crazy, only hopeful. These were people who, for example, were hurt by globalization. These are people who, for example, were hurt badly by the 2008 depression. And it is a depression. And these are people who, to this day, have not been able to find work. But, you know, they're looking for something. They're looking for anybody who is going to be able to help them get their homes back, help them get some semblance of a decent job back. And they're hearing promises. But do you seriously think these promises are going to be delivered on? I think not. Time will tell. I wouldn't place any bets on it, ladies and gentlemen. I think he is going to be President Donald the Brief.
E.T. Burnham. E.T. Burnham.
That's just loyal.
Well, Brad Little and Michael Moore, I'd say at least five people in the room know these names. Brad Little, well known to us as a peace guy, wrote an email about September or so with a essay from Michael Moore. And he said, Brad Little said, "This sounds really pretty smart to me. I think Michael Moore is correct." So I printed that out. I can't read it on the computer. I read that thoroughly, and I said, which it said that the president-elect would win. I didn't believe it. I read it over, thought it over, and said, no, into the recycling. Well, it shows you what I know. But Brad Little and Michael Moore were right, not me. Also, I want to mention Why America Failed, Morris Berman. He talked about how the country was going downhill in this book. He left the country. He left the country. He said, "I've had it." I suspect if he's alive now, he's saying, "See what I told you?" So that's my initial reaction on the election. Now on the speaker, I think the speaker, one thing I disagree with the speaker a bit on is how many countries in the world are so good that they've done all these wonderful things. I admit, yes, the Nordic countries, yes. New Zealand, yes. Perhaps Japan, Australia. And then even parts of European Union, not all of them, not all of them, yes, they've got all these things he's talking about. But there are about 200 countries in the world, and most of them, I suspect, over 150 of them. If they had a chance to move here, they'd move in a minute. Even some of the ones from the European Union, like Bulgaria. We've got an intern from Bulgaria now at Jane Addams Senior Caucus, and another one from Hungary. I think both of them implied to me that, hey, if they, many of people in their country had a chance, they'd come here. I don't see many people going to Bulgaria from here or Hungary from here. So I'm not touting how wonderful the United States is. I'm just saying the rest of the world is pretty bad. And we are going downhill, I agree with that. But even Canada, I've heard the time George W. Bush, second election, I know a person who said, I think I've thought about being an expatriate and going to Canada. Well, that same year, more people were coming here from Canada than going from Canada to, from the United States to Canada. So this is a paradox, but it's something we gotta think about. The rest of the world isn't very good either. And I'm afraid we're trying to get down there too. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. I'm Andy Anderson, for any of you that might not know me. First thing I want to enter into the record for the film, anybody that might be watching this on YouTube, is the name of this book, Unprecedented Climate Mobilization. It describes the wake-up call that the world needs to do a 4 or 5 year mobilization, industrial mobilization like we did in World War II. From 1901 to 1945, the car companies built 139 cars, but they built thousands and thousands of planes, bombers, trucks. Ford cranked out a B-24 bomber every 63 minutes on their assembly lines. So we can mass produce the things needed to solve the problem of catastrophic climate change that is now recognized by the U.S. military as the number one threat to our country. Not terrorism or anything else, it's climate change. America's a great country. You know, we have millions of good people here. But we are living in a media-generated bubble of ignorance and pathology. We are failing to recognize, because the media doesn't write about it at all, that out of all the millions and millions and millions of good people, we have just a few dozen, really, a few dozen pathetic billionaire predators that are running this country. And they buy and sell, just like trading cards, our senators and congressmen. I've said it many times before, I brag about our Senate and Congress. Our government, our Senate and the Congress is the best, smoothest running, best financed whorehouse in the world. It's an intellectual whorehouse, and people are paid to lie to us. The media, if the media told the truth about what's in books like this, we would have a different opinion of what happened in this election. In 2000, George Bush lost. He lost the vote. And then when it became clear that he was the loser, his Republican criminal friends in various places stopped the vote. The Supreme Court installed it. In 2004, George and Dick were voted out in a landslide. We all went to bed celebrating. They changed the vote totals in 11 states on the electronic machines after we went to sleep. Came out in the morning. I call that the greatest psychological rape of millions of people this country has ever seen. 2006, Americans were getting disgusted, they were beginning to take back control of Congress. In 2008, the criminals, Bush-Cheney crime machine was voted out. Who cares if it was Obama or any other Democrat? A whole bunch of people weren't voting for Obama, they were voting the criminals out. In 2010, through massive corporate criminal activity with the voting machines again, the Republicans took back control of the Congress. 2012, more of the same, but Obama was still in. 2014, 89 Republicans, disgusting people involved in all kinds of criminal slush fund activity in Congress. The newspaper said, how can Americans be so stupid to keep voting these people in? Well, we didn't vote them in. We voted them out. And then they changed the vote tolls. It's called the red shift. After people go to sleep, they just change the tolls and the votes shift into the red column. It's never a blue shift. In 2016 now, Bernie Sanders was the clear winner. He got more votes nationwide than Hillary did. The media just lied to us from day one saying Hillary's winning, Hillary's winning. It was bald-faced lies. It wasn't a difference of opinion. Every time Bernie would win a caucus, they say Bernie's a loser because Hillary's got more votes. And when it became necessary to shut Bernie down finally, they called the vote in California and everything else for Hillary. They called her the winner before people even had a chance to vote. So that brings us to last Tuesday. Hillary Clinton was the clear winner. She got 300 and some odd electoral votes. Trump got around 200 or so. Then they went ahead, but they held up the vote. They were counting it late in the night to see which key states, swing states, they have to flip the electronic poll to make Trump the winner. So that's what we got. Trump lost, and the Republican criminals that run the voting machines, they switched enough votes after we went to bed to give them the win. If we don't start facing these realities of what's going on, was it somebody from Stalin or Russia? Who can remember here? I think it was somebody from Russia that said, it doesn't matter who votes, it matters who counts the votes. That's where we are. And it's the media is running a smooth, coordinated blackout on what's been happening in our voting system for the last 15 years. Thank you.
Oh, okay. That one was right.
Yeah.
All right. How much time we got there?
Yeah, we say 27, Charlie.
Oh, we got. We're not as late then. That's all I'm worried about. All right, let's thank our speaker, really. That was a, I've got a better understanding of where he's coming from, in this thing here. I'll be eclectic as usual here. I'm not going to talk about the election. We're going to save that for next week. I'm sure we'll be revisiting this topic here. The only thing I will say, I'm amazed we've elected someone who couldn't pass. I used to teach civics at elementary school on occasion, and I don't think he could pass a seventh grader test. This is, man, is president of the United States. seriously, it is complex. I have no understanding. I've been going to Congress for 35 years, and even I have no idea. I keep a handbook on it, and to drop somebody in that, it's just not going to work. Anyhow, what you're advocating, sir, is, I believe, would be classified as a controlled economy. Capitalists don't like that. They claim they want, to do what they want so they can be as unethical as they can be. You don't succeed in business by being ethical. And that's not there. What you're trying to do is to combine capitalism and humanism. And they're two disparate philosophies. You probably couldn't find two disparate. One thinks only of yourself, the individual, and the other one as the scope that is expansive, in which all thought is upon just the opposite. So you have narrow scope and broad scope in conflict. How you can resolve that, I don't know. Government does not interfere in business only out of necessity, because it is corrupt and dangerous. And those who accrue power through economic means misuse it. And one thing about businesses that you have to understand is the more unethical you are, the more likely you are to succeed. That's why I will never enter that, and I have chosen to be a civil service employee my entire life because I've seen that. I don't want to become one of them. The capitalist doesn't, here's the other thing about capitalism, they mistreat their own people who are making them, who are creating their wealth for them. Labor creates wealth. They mistreat these people. They may, and to say that they are going to expansively suddenly care for the community, they don't care about the people who are making, bringing them profit, personal profit. And they are going to expand for, they are going to care about somebody who does not enrich themselves personally. This is not going to happen. They can't think that way. Talk to that wall. You'll be better off. You've heard one or two here tonight. It's worth it, though. We've got to do it. And this little thing here that this government is not all, that is the biggest bunch of hooey. That is ridiculous. You have no idea about government appropriations. Have you ever heard of an Office of Inspector General?
Yes.
Do you realize they're in their constant audit? I have defended probably several hundred people who got disciplined under government audits. Are you for real? This is the kind of things you hear from these, what, Republicans or libertarians that are nonsense? What do these people do? Get themselves fired and disciplined? You know, that's what an inspector general office does. Don't you know about the appropriation process? I don't know what else I've got to cover here. Anyhow, thank you very much. I think you've got it. Oh, the other thing is about this election, you know, all this stuff about, we are talking about this, if you can eliminate this, I've heard a new term here, there's economic anxiety. Well, what do you expect under free market capitalism? Inherently, it's the basis of it is economic anxiety. That's why they get people to do things they normally wouldn't do, is to eliminate that. Anxiety is fear of the unknown. All right, Andy, that was good. Thank you for helping out, too.
All right.
Thank you, Timmy.
All right.
Most of all, I should thank our speaker.
Yes.
I did it all.
The speaker gets the last word.
Speaker gets the last word.
Yes. Do you want to say a few words at the end here?
Yeah, just a minute. He's a communist.
You got 6 or 7 minutes.
Oh, okay. Take all of it. A couple of months ago, someone said to me, is there anything that Donald Trump could say to get you to vote for him? And I said, well, the problem is not what he could say. I would have to close my eyes and act like I haven't known anything that he's done in the past 30 years. I come from Detroit, and I've lived here in Chicago for 25 years now, before I grew up in Detroit. And one of the things when I was growing up was talked about was bringing casino gaming to Detroit. So I happened to work with and know people who were interested in bringing casino gaming to Detroit. And we had a meeting with Donald Trump. And after that, and there were some things that were talked about at the meeting. And then at the meeting, then after the meeting, people met again, the folks who had met, they said, this is the weirdest guy. I mean, we talked to him about one thing, and we said, you know, this is what we're looking at, how we were going to frame this conversation regarding casino gaming in Detroit. And then he said he agreed, but then he stepped outside there, got in front of the cameras, and went blank and totally, you know, went south on us. And so, and there were other incidents of people who have had to, who have tried to work with him in the past and come to find out that, you know, we're on the wrong page. I think that what's going to happen is he's, I heard someone say shortly after Tuesday, the good thing is, or maybe it was on Tuesday, the good thing is that Donald Trump is not committed to anything that he says. So that's the best thing that we've got going for us. So anyway, that's all. So I'm not going to go much more into the, everyone will have their opinions about what's going on. I just, you know, I think that we'll survive it. Like I said to someone the day afterward, as far as us as people, as black people, we survived slavery, Jim Crow, the new Jim Crow, segregation. I think we can withstand Trump for the next 4 years. We have to, so unfortunately, we'll have to survive that. But a couple of things folks said, someone said that if I open up a business, they should be allowed to just open up their business without having it, you know, cleared with anybody. Well, there, first of all, you can't do that now. You can't just open up a business that you want to open up now. There are guidelines, requirements, and regulations. So, and there may be even a denial of you having the option to opening up that business. So what we're talking about with work with the commission is that part of that evaluation process as far as what businesses are opening and what industries we're making way for, that they have a community sustainability perspective on it, and that it will not be adverse to community development.
Can't you just bribe them? Pay them off.
So, someone else said, I believe it was Charlie, what we're talking about is a controlled economy. The commission would be talking about a controlled economy. And the only thing I could say is, welcome to America. We have a controlled economy. And that's the problem. It's so controlled that there is no such thing as free enterprise. Only certain people will win. That's how it's set up. And that's what we want to disrupt. We want to disrupt that. At our first meeting, that was what our vice chair of the commission said. Our purpose is to disrupt the current business traditional models and how those objectives of fast profits, low expenses, irregardless of community impact. We want to disrupt that. We have to disrupt that. And yes, there are more countries that don't have which may not have the intellect as ours to put the same stipulation as others. But the ones that are, I mean, you know, granted, Germany's had some challenges, but we're not just talking about the Scandinavian countries. We're talking about larger members of the of European and international world markets too, that are also coming into this understanding of social entrepreneurship and social enterprise. I have a note here. Something says, someone mentioned a point that we're talking about trying to make ethical business. Business is ethical, and yes, we are, because it's not only ethical. And I will tell you something else. Being responsible is profitable, because there are people who are willing to pay more if they know that the company they're buying for has a broader community sense or is connected to something else. We have those companies that are doing that now, and what we found out is that consumers who are choice consumers will choose to do as much good as they can. So we're talking about supporting and encouraging that. And
I think Charlie said something else about they don't care about us or something like that.
They don't care about their own employees. Why should they care about the community?
Well, you're absolutely right, and that's why we want to utilize every opportunity we have under this commission to help them understand the importance of caring about their own, their employees, the community, and the impact of the services that they provide. All we're talking about doing is trying to make things fair. That's all we're looking at, and that there's a broader aspect of it.
How come your commission website hasn't been updated in 3 months?
Because we have one staff person.
and
I was told that he was going to get it done before the holiday, but I guess he didn't. They had a holiday this week, so we're working on a shoestring.
Co-op employees are lazy.
The what?
Co-op employees.
What? Co-op employees?
Yeah, are lazy.
Anyway, as always, you know, I have to say two things I forgot. Someone asked about my background. I also have been a committeeman for the Green Party, and I see Wes there, so I had to put that in there, even though Charlie thinks the Green Party is hooey, as he says it.
Spoilers.
How can they be spoilers? They didn't even get 5%. What are you talking about? So then that's number one. And then I have to also comment about how, you know, I had spoken before at the College of Complexes when you were at the Lincoln.
Right.
I see you guys closed that place down, but but you've got some nice fancier digs here now, really nice, and it's always good to come and talk and dialogue with the people here, and I appreciate the opportunity every time.
Let's give our speaker one more round of applause. Why don't you go ahead and close us out tonight at the college? Why don't you go ahead and close us out?
I do remember. Yeah.
All right.
About 15 years
ago. Mark.
I want
us. Huh?
Hey,
what do you want?
You need
right.
An ITDL.
Oh, yeah. To the red line.
Come with us.
Okay, all right.
Anybody else?
And we are adjourned.
Okay.